I know we got one text this morning that said, turning around, the roads are bad. And I guess up north they're worse. So Ted and Georgie Nelson are here. We speak blessing over their trip. They're heading north. Give them a hand. Hallelujah. Ted, I know we had planned on the Packers and the Bengals, but it ain't going to be the Bengals. I'm sure of that. They got beat. Yeah. Not so sure I'd hold the breath on the other thing either. But praise God. God is good, is he not? And seems like they had a couple other things I wanted. Yeah, I want to just get into a couple jokes here. Just a couple quick ones. Is that all right? This Bengal fan, now these are not theologically correct. This Bengal fan, he died and he went to hell. And he was in hell and he said, the devil said, well, what do you think of the temperature? He said, that's nothing. He goes, that's like Cincinnati in June. So the devil gets mad and he turns the temperature up. And he says, what do you think of it now? He says, that's nothing. That's like Cincinnati in July. He says, he's really mad now. So he turns it up. He says, well, what do you think of it now? He says, that's nothing. That's like Cincinnati in August. This time, he says, the devil turns it all the way down. Pipes are steaming. You know, it's all going and things are freezing. So he starts jumping up and down. He said, what happened? He said, the Bengals won the Super Bowl. Hell froze over. Get it? All right. So here's another one quickly, and then we'll get this done. This is why what people will, you know, will give up for a good marriage. It's, you know, you just need to hear it. It says a man and his wife, they went for marriage counseling. The counselor looks at the man and his wife and proceeds to give the man's wife a very long, passionate kiss. The counselor then looks at the husband and says, you need to make sure your wife experiences this at least 3 times a week, and I suggest Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. The husband thinks about it. Then he replies, well, I can drop her off on Monday and Wednesday, but Friday's my golf day. Well, are you excited, guys? I'm going to talk about how, well, let me do one more thing here. And this is something I want to do. This is on a serious note. You know, guys, we need to remember the persecuted church. We need to pray for the persecuted church. We have been doing that in our prayer groups on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Friday from 8 to 9. And I want to encourage you to remember the persecuted church. I just want to give you one quick one so we can keep this in perspective. Amen? We need to keep things in perspective. We're not dealing with much here, okay? But some of these people are. This is in Ethiopia. A church elder trying to help a woman being attacked outside his church in Ethiopia was killed August the 30th. The attackers assaulted the woman and others, including church elder Godena, 55, who was dragged back inside the church and hacked to death with machetes. Voice of the Martyrs reports. The attackers returned two other times, wounding many, and it says pray for Godena, as well as healing for those attacked. Pray also for the conversion of the attackers, and we do that right now in Jesus' mighty name. These kind of things happen, guys, in the world, and we don't need to turn a deaf ear. Hebrews 13:3 says, remember those that are bound or imprisoned as bound with him, and those which suffer adversity as yourselves also in the body. So we're going to remember them. Amen. If you was in prison for the gospel, would you want someone praying for you and doing what they can do for you? I know I would. Praise the Lord. How to answer Jesus' prayer. Who wants to answer Jesus' prayer? You know Jesus had a prayer? Do you know that? Yeah? No. Not that the Packers win the Super Bowl, but he did have a prayer. But go to first. I'm just going to start with 1 John chapter 4, verse 17. Well, I'll tell you what. No, John 17, 21. And then we'll go to 1 John 4, 16. I just want to show you this. Guys, I'm excited. I'll tell you what. I this is just so... so good. In fact, Jen, take this thing right here so I can get less stuff out of my way. That they all, this is Jesus' prayer. Back up to verse 20, please. And this is Jesus' prayer. Jesus is saying, neither pray I for these alone. In other words, he said, I'm not just praying for my immediate disciples around me, but I'm also praying for, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word. In other words, everyone down through the ages that would believe on Jesus through their word, right? I'm praying for all them. That would include you and I, correct? All right. Now look at the next verse. That they all may be one. And we're going to talk about this. I'm going to talk about love. I'm going to talk about hate. I'm going to talk about all these things. Jesus is praying that we all may be one. Now, I understand positionally, if we're born again, and the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 6:17, he that is joined unto the Lord is one spirit. But he wants us to be one and move as a unit, as an organism. Amen? It's called the church. We're going to talk about the church. Because there's a lot of people saying, man, the church is, man, I'm the church, you're the church, my goldfish is the church, you know, my cat's the church. It's a bunch of bunk. The church is a gathering of individual believers corporately together. That's the church. Amen. See, there's a lot of rebellion in our society that masquerades as spirituality. It's not spirituality, it's rebellion. Do you know you need each other? We need each other. I know people don't like that, but it's the truth. That's how God set it up. But watch this. Jesus prayed that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me and I in thee. You think the Father and Jesus move as one? I think so. That they also may be one in us, that the world... So this isn't just a position, guys. He's not talking about just our position, is he? Why? He says that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. In other words, this affects the world. If it was just a position, if he was just talking about our position of one with him and one with each other in Christ, then he would, then it would, what would that be to the world? Oh, you're one with him, yeah, whatever. They need to see it, guys. 1 John chapter 4, verse 16. I want to say some things here, guys. I'm really excited about this. You and I cannot effectively function without the church. Oh, Chris, I am the church. Now, somebody pipe that off for us a little bit, okay? You said that, Chris. Okay, I got it. All right. And we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. Love you, brother. Love is an action, guys. Love manifests in an action. Now, I know religion has taught us to do something without knowing him, and that's wrong, right? So, you know, if you just go do something that's not based, the Bible says if you give your body to be burned and it's not motivated by the love of God, it profits you nothing, right? So it's not just doing, that's religious doo-doo, right? But I'm going to show you this. I'm after something. I'm going to go through some of these verses fast because I'm after something. Go ahead, next. Herein is love, or our love, that's actually should be the love that's in us, been shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. Here's how it's perfected or made complete, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. Now, we talked about this before. The day of judgment he's talking about here is not a future judgment. The day of judgment is when something comes against me, such as sickness, that Jesus has already been judged for. I can have boldness in that day of judgment. How do you know that's talking about that? Because the rest of the verse says, because as he is, so are we in this world. He's not talking about in the future. He's talking about right now. We've talked about this. We got to get this. The day of judgment is when something, if depression comes against you, you know, you don't have to be depressed. That's right. You're to be far from oppression, we're told in Isaiah. Far from it. Why? Jesus was judged for that. Jesus was judged for every curse that is even in the earth. He was judged for it. Amen? So in that day of judgment, when something comes against you that Jesus has already been judged for, you can have boldness. Why? And because as he is, so are you in this world. And because of that, you can have boldness in the day of judgment. Now look at the next verse. There is no fear in love. How many of you like fear? I didn't think so. I hate fear. Fear is torturous, right? The Bible says it has torment. And I've told you that that Greek word torment there is found one other place in the New Testament. It's in Matthew 25, verse 46, the Greek word. And it actually is there. It's translated where the goats go into everlasting punishment. It's referring to hell. And that's the word used here for torment. Only two places in the entire New Testament. Only two places. Isn't that amazing? That's how torturous fear is. It's like hell. It's a form of hell. Ooh, hear that wind? I thought, man, we got a railroad track around here. There's no fear in love. So the key is not to try to get rid of fear. The key is to find out how much he loves you. And that'll get rid of fear. Now, with that said, because fear is torment. He that fears has not been made perfect or has not matured in this love. God's not mad at him. Then this verse says, we love him because he first loved us. Leave that up there. The word him in your Bible, in your King James or your New King James, is italics. It's not in the original. The Greek actually says we love. The New American Standard brings it out that way. Now, it's not wrong to say we love him, because we do. But we love, period. We just love because he first loved us. See, this is the crux of the New Covenant. See, for years we've been taught, you need to love God, man. You need to try harder. You need to love God. How'd that work for us? It didn't. You know, the harder you try. I used to get so frustrated. I remember on a phone conversation one time, and I remember telling the guy, I said, you know what amazes me about me? How much I can seek God and still feel like it's not enough. Anybody ever been there? That was me. That was me, man. But it was never enough. I never felt like I loved God enough because I wasn't perfect at anything. Never have been. At doing anything. And I never felt like I loved God enough. But now I found out, wow, it's about God's love for me. Whew. That takes a big weight off your back. Amen? But now here's where we're going. Go to the next two verses. First one. If a man say, a lot of people say, I love God, but he hates his brother, he is a liar. Wow. If I say I love God, but I hate my brother or sister in Christ, or hate, period, I'm a liar. Well, phew, that ain't me, man. I don't hate anybody. Well, you need to understand the definition for hate. Hate is the Greek word maseo, and one of its definitions is to detest. I had a friend, a good guy, defined it to me this way. He says it means to do harm through activity or inactivity. Now watch this. We're going somewhere, people. What does it mean to hate? He goes, that's what hate. Now watch. If a man say, I love God and I hate his brother. See, just to say, I don't need people. Oh, I love them, but I don't need them. You know, that's hate. It's inactivity. To not, if I love God, Jesus said, if you love me, you'll do what I say. That's not earning righteousness. I mean, isn't that simple? Sometimes I think we get so deep, we get dumb. Amen? If I love my wife and I'm always mean to her and my actions are inconsistent, but yet I say I love her, we got a problem, Houston. Okay, if a man say I love God and he hates his brother, he is a liar. For he that loves not his brother whom he has seen with his physical eye, how can he love God whom he hath not seen? Now, we're talking about this. Once again, hate is not just activity. It can be an activity. Give me a water. But we'll come right back here. Jump over to Proverbs 13:24. Proverbs chapter 13 and verse 24. Watch this. And we'll come right back here. He that spares his rod hates his son, but he that loves him chasteneth him betimes, which means early and diligently. But here's what I want you to see. He that spares when he needs it, little Johnny, hates his son. Now question, is this hatred activity or inactivity? One more time. Is it activity or inactivity? It's inactivity. See, I'm trying to expand your understanding of how God sees hate. It's different. Proverbs 29, verse 24. Look at this one. Proverbs chapter 29 and verse 24. Whoso is a partner with a thief hates his own soul. Now, there's a lot of things we could say about this. There's a lot of implications. But just to partner with a thief hates his own life, his own soul. He hears cursing and he doesn't expose it. There's all kinds of spiritual things we could say here. But think about this. He that is just a partner with a thief. You know, if you partner with an ideology or a belief system that says you don't need the church or you don't need God's people, you're partnering with a thief. You know why? You know why? Listen, Jesus, the church was Jesus' idea. Did you know that? Now, jump back to 1 John, chapter, 4, verse 20. 1 John, chapter 4, verse 20. Look at this. If a man say, let's go to verse 21. last verse of this chapter. And this commandment have we from him. I know, see, a lot of grace people think commandment's a new covenant cuss word. It's not. It's not. These aren't commandments to be righteous. These are commandments because you are righteous. In fact, the Greek word for commandment is entole. You know what that means? That which is prescribed to one by reason of his office. What is our office? Sons of God. God commands us to love because his love's been shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. Amen. There's a lot. See, a lot of people think grace is just rebellion to any type of law. That's not grace. That's deception. Amen. If you're under grace, you mean you just grace reigns through righteousness. New covenant grace. Romans 5:21. So God's grace, God's unmerited favor, his ability, all that, it reigns through who I am in Christ, the righteousness of God in him. So notice what he says. Here's a commandment we have from him that if I love God, I need to love you. But I don't need those people. You're partnering with a thief. That's a partner of a thief. We need each other, guys. That's why we started this study on Tuesday at 10 a.m. on doing church as a team. Our whole society has become independent. I mean, we've become like, well, I'm a self-made man or self-made woman. No, you're not. That's called deception. We need each other. Luke chapter 10, verse 25. Let me show you this. This is powerful stuff, guys. Hallelujah. Luke chapter, I've got something I want to read to you also. And behold, a son. You know what? Before we go here, let me show you something. We're going to come right back here. Jump over to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 28. And I want to read this to you. I want to make sure I don't forget to do this. We're coming right back here. But I want to show you this. 1 Corinthians, and God has set some in the church. Notice where he set them, in the church. Wow, he's talking about the church worldwide, right? Well, yeah. But he's talking about the church. Listen to the Greek definition for church. One time I was taking a bath. I know I do that every now and then. Aubrey, our three-year-old granddaughter, she's so funny. What did she say to me the other day? How did that go? She said, I go, Aubrey, why do I need to take a bath? Do I smell? She goes, yes. I didn't smell because I already had a bath. She was just saying that. But God has set some in the church. First apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers, and on it goes. But notice where they're set. They're set in the church. Now watch this. I was taking this bath. I was getting out of the bathtub. And I heard the Lord say, look up the Greek word for church. Because ecclesia, it's called out of the world. It's not what it means. That's what I thought too. Here's what it means. Ecclesia, according to Thayer's lexicon. Lexicon is a fancy word for? Dictionary, thank you. Dictionary, all right. And here's what Thayer says. Ecclesia, a gathering of citizens called out from their homes into some public place, an assembly. That's God's definition. And you know, I did, look at this. I wrote down, I forget how many scriptures just on church in the New Testament. And if your goldfish is the church, I got a problem with some of these verses because I can't make them fit. I can't make them fit. You know why? Because they don't fit. God loves the church. The gates of hell will not prevail against the church. They might prevail against you as an individual, but they're not going to prevail against the church. You lock arms with fellow believers. There's strength when we're united. Amen? And God doesn't want to prevail against you either. We're individuals. We don't lose our individuality, but we function as a unit. That's God's idea. I may get into some of these verses, probably not, won't have time. But God set some in the church, those who are called from their homes into the public assembly. Now go back to Luke chapter 10, verse 25. Watch this. And behold, a certain lawyer, I'm trying to hold off the jokes here, stood up and tempted him, saying, Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Now just think about this. How do you do something to inherit? You can't. You inherit, right? So his question was off base from the get-go, right out of the gate. So he asked him a question. There's a lot of things we could say out of here. I'm only going to hit a few. He said unto him, you know, Jesus should have just said, well, just believe on me, right? Why didn't he say that? Because notice what he said. What is written in the law? How readest thou? Man, there's so much in this verse. Why didn't he just say, just believe on me? Because this man was self-deceived. See, the law has a place. The Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 1, you got to know it's not made for a righteous man. But it is made for those who are deceived into self-deception. And that's what this guy was. But notice what he said. How do you read it? How do you read it? And okay, go to the next verse. And he answering said unto him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy strength, with all thy mind, and thy neighbor as thyself. Next verse. And he said unto him, you've answered right. Notice, but he's talking about the law. Remember we just read in 1 John 4:19? We love because he first loved us. Man, see, I always say this, you can't understand the good news until you first grasp the bad news. That we are totally, completely, spiritually bankrupt without him. Amen? And you know, and that doesn't change just because I'm born again. I need to keep abiding in him, keep depending upon him, keep realizing he's the author and the finisher of my faith, and I don't somehow, my flesh don't somehow get it together. Amen? And that's a big one right there. We keep our dependency anchored in him. But notice he said, Jesus just said, you've answered right. Go ahead and do this and you'll live. See, but the guy knew in his heart, you can't do this. And you go to the next verse. But he willing to justify himself said unto Jesus, and who is my neighbor? And this guy's trying to get some kind of peace on the inside. He's trying to get some kind of resolve. Okay, you told me to do this, but who's my neighbor? I mean, is Rich my neighbor and then John isn't? Or how does this all work? Who's my neighbor? Who do I have to love like I love you? Next verse. And Jesus answering said, and he illustrates his story, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment and wounded him and departed, leaving him half dead. Well, we can say a lot about this. You know, people walking around are half dead. They're physically alive, but on the inside they're dead because they've been beat up by life and they've been born into sin, et cetera, et cetera. We could go on. But that's the way a lot of people, even believers who have the very life of Christ in them, many of them live sometimes like they're half dead, like they're just existing instead of really living. God has not called us to exist. He's called us to live. And that living is the same kind of life that God himself experiences. Amen. That's in you, man. Rejoice. Rich said something so good the other night. We were talking about when you struggle and fight different sicknesses and ailments and stuff like that. Hey, and by the way, let's not pretend we don't have issues and we don't battle things. I hate charismatic fakeness. You know, Paul said, I left Trophimus at Miletum sick. You know, that no, it's not God's will. We believe in healing every single time. But guess what? We're in a fight. Help me get it through. Amen. All right. But Rich said something so good. He said, you know, just like Paul and Silas, when they're in prison, they were praising God. You know, even when you're dealing with something, you can praise God. That's a great time to praise God. You know when it's a great time to praise God? Anytime. Amen. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, the Lord's name is to be praised. Lift up your voice. Declare that God is good. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Open your mouth. Begin to praise him. Begin to thank him. We've got so much. We are so packed. I like what he said too. He said, Lord, help us see how blessed we are. All right. So this man went down. They stripped him, left him half dead. Look at verse 31. And by chance, there came down a certain priest that way. And when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. Question, did this priest, religious guy, if hatred is activity or inactivity, what kind of hatred would this be? Inactivity. Did the guy need help? Right? He just passed by on the other side. Next verse. And likewise, a Levite, another religious guy, when he was at the place, came and looked on him and passed by on the other side. You know what this is? It's hatred. The guy needs help. He's half dead. He's laying there. He's bloodied. He's beat up. And they're passing by. I love you, man. I love you. I don't want to get involved, though. I don't want to get involved. This guy's half dead. That's hatred. In God's eyes, that's hatred. See, we don't think of it like that. We think, well, I didn't go over and shoot him or anything. I didn't do nothing bad to him. But it's hatred. It's hatred to not get involved with people that need you. We need you. You need us. It's a form of hatred. Listen, that's not condemnation. That's biblical. It's challenging you to come up to the grace of God that's in you. See, we got two. Why do we have to wait till our lives are falling apart before we cry out to God? I just did a post on why do we have to, why do we only pray for people? Why do they assume that there's always something wrong? How about praying for me when things are going good? Make mention of me in prayer and vice versa. If we do that more, maybe there'd be less people going through stuff. Oh, his life's falling apart. Call the prayer team. How about everything's going great? Call the prayer team. Look at this. He passed by on the other side. Hatred. Next verse. And let me tell you something. There's people around us all the time that are living half dead. Half dead. Lots of them go to church. They're living half dead. They're not living the abundant life. And the abundant life has nothing to do with how much is in your bank account. It can affect that, but it has everything to do with what's in your heart account. How much you realize this abundant, man, I have Jesus. I'm going to heaven. I got heaven in me. I can live heaven now. Hallelujah. And then, I love this, but a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion on him. Now, let me say this right away. For years, the church taught that you and I were the good Samaritan if we did these things. Wrong, wrong, wrong. Jesus is the good Samaritan. Now, the good Samaritan wants to live through us, and that's the difference. Amen? The good Samaritan wants to manifest his life through us, but you can't do something and all of a sudden become the good Samaritan. And by the way, let me tell you something about Samaritans. The Jews hated the Samaritans because they were interracial, which I think speaks of Jews and Gentiles. Jesus came for all mankind, not just the Jew. But anyhow, a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, he came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion on him. Who had compassion on the human race? Yeshua, Jesus. Next verse. Watch this. And went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring in oil and wine, I believe it's talking about the Holy Spirit, and set him on his own beast and brought him to an inn and took care of him. Now, I'm going to give you my Christology, which is totally correct. Ted and I have come to the conclusion that we're the only two that have perfect doctrine. Right, Ted? It's our story and we're sticking with it. All right? And it, yeah. It's like pouring in oil. He brought him, he took care of him, and he brought him to where? An inn. You know what the inn is? It's the church. I believe it's the church. He brought him to an inn. He brought him somewhere. He brought him to a place, and he took care of him. Look at the next verse. And on the morrow when he departed, you know, Jesus has physically departed, only he's with us in the person of the Holy Spirit in our heart. People say, wait a minute, has he departed or is he with us? Answer, both. Both, right? But he said, I don't leave you comfortless. I will not leave you as orphans, John 14, 18. I'm coming to live in you in the person of the Holy Ghost. But so, and on the morrow when he departed physically, he took out 2 pence, denarion, Roman silver coin. Comes from denarius, I believe. It's a Roman silver coin. If you want to get into typology, silver speaks of redemption. He took out 2. Why 2? I believe it speaks of what needed to be taken care of in his physical departure, which is what? Our body and our soul. Our spirit's already taken care of. Our spirit's already one with him. So he took out these 2. He took him to the inn. He put him in the church. He set him in the church. And he took out 2 pence. 2. Why? The Spirit's a done deal. But how many know as long as we're here, you know there's going to be no need for the church in heaven? Because there's nothing to be called out to. It's all going to be the church. Amen? We don't have to be called out of anything. But you know here there's a need because we're in a broken world. And in the end, notice what he did. He goes, I took out two pence. Why? So our soul realm can be taken care of and our physical realm can be taken care of. Our spirit's already sealed and done deal. Next verse. Oh, no. Keep that up there. And gave them to the host. Who's the host? The Holy Ghost is the host with the most. Amen? It's the Holy Ghost. He gave them to the host. He gave them to the host. Who's the one that takes care of us? Who's the one that takes the finished work of Jesus and makes it a reality in our life? It's the Holy Spirit of God. Amen? Can you see it? It's the Holy Spirit. You know, if I rebel against what God says, that's why I said, I don't know that I'm going to get in all these scriptures on the church, but it's mind-boggling. So I challenge you to take your concordance and look up every verse in the New Testament on church. Look it up. And with the definition I gave you from the Greek, begin to meditate on it. You'll find out the church is hugely important. I have discovered that people that do not function in a body of believers, at the end of their life, they do nothing or very little for God. Does God still love them? Absolutely. If they're born again, they go straight to heaven. But God has called us to function together. In fact, let me read this to you. This rocked my world. Arby's design on here. But this is amazing. This is from a guy named Danny Silk. I don't know much about him, but this is a powerful quote. Addictions are cycles that emerge in our lives when we cannot reduce our pain and anxiety through loving, intimate connections with people. I'm going to read it again. Think about this. Not with God. God, yes, with God, but God through his people. Addictions, addictive behavior. How many people have I heard say, man, they got depressed and they started overeating? Ted, our problem isn't depression. We just like food. That's another subject. No, but seriously, they get these addictive behaviors, whatever that is. Listen to this. Addictions are cycles that emerge in our lives when we cannot reduce our pain and anxiety through loving, intimate connections with other people. Somehow I'm cut off from other people. You don't have anybody you can talk to. You don't have anybody you can share it with. You get cut off from other people. Now, I'm going to come right back here to Luke 10:35. Look at 1 John 1:7. 1 John chapter 1, verse 7. Watch this. 1 John chapter 1 and verse 7. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, what is the result of walking in the light? Walk. Not if we're in the light. If you're born again, the light of God is you're in light. But if you walk in it, that's an ongoing activity. We have fellowship with Jesus. One with another. One with another. You know, Satan has attacked some things in our society. And one of them, you might say, well, the family. Well, yes. What is the family? It's a unit. You know what else he's attacked? The church family. Hates the church. Doesn't want you establishing. This isn't something to get you to come here, by the way. This is reality. This is something we need. This is something I need. To realize how important we are to each other. Look at this. If I walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And this always messed me up bad. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. And you know what else messed me up? When I went to the Greek. Because the Greek says the cleansing is present tense, which is a continuous, ongoing action with no end in sight. And it's contingent upon me walking in the light. And I thought, what's up with that, Lord? I thought I was already cleansed by the blood. He's talking about in the other two parts, in your soul and in your body. Yes, in my spirit's a done deal. But how many know my soul and my body are in process? In fact, my body, I'm going to get a new one. Can you hear this? Back to the two pence. Now back to Luke chapter 10, I believe it's verse 35. Hallelujah. Luke chapter 10, verse 35. And on the morrow, when he departed, he took out two pence and gave them to the host and said unto him, take care of him. And whatsoever you spend more, when I come again, I will repay. I'll make everything right. Next verse. How many of you know everything's going to go to right? You know, all you people, oh, that's an injustice. That's an injustice. There's no injustice in the big picture when God makes it right. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes chapter 8 and verse 11, because sentence against an evil, and some people think sin doesn't matter. It doesn't matter as far as between you and God. But if I'm sitting there hurting you, it matters. You know, any good father, if you mess with my kids, I love you, but I'm going to defend my kids. Right? You would too. I hope you would. Right? But you know, the Bible says in Ecclesiastes 8:11, because sentence against an evil work is not executed speedily, therefore the hearts of the sons of men are fully set to do evil. I remember that day we was eating breakfast and the day they hung Saddam Hussein. And the butcher of Baghdad, I actually felt sorry for him. I said, this is your end. This is it. And if you don't know Jesus, you're not going to heaven. Isn't that something? But that, I mean, there's no, people don't get away with things. They only think they do. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Guess we're looking at. This is grace, man. This is new covenant grace. See, what I can't stand is all this balance that's imbalance that's masquerading as grace. It's not grace. People going around saying everybody's saved and all this other nonsense. If everybody's saved, then why did Jesus come? Why did he come? See, I want to do something fun. I think I'll die on the cross. That sounds like fun. No, he came and God wasn't mad. Read the Bible. God was angry at sin. It's all over both testaments. Now they're trying to redefine that. See, it's all because of religious ignorance. God loves us. But I think it's so vital that we stay in the inn and we allow the Holy Ghost to administer to us. Okay, which now of these three, and he's asking the guy, was neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves? Now, let me say something. There were three of them, remember? Two of them in activity, the Levite and the priest. Correct? One of them, which the Good Samaritan, Jesus, who wants to live through us and be the Good Samaritan through us. Hear the difference. So yes, we do it, but we just don't do it to be the Good Samaritan. We do it because the Good Samaritan lives in us. We respond to him. Okay? That's a big difference. We don't live for God. We allow God to live through us. There's a difference. Okay, so which of these was neighbor? Was it the one that passed by, the other one that passed by, or the one that reached out and helped him? The one that reached out and helped him, correct? The one that actively got involved. Next verse. And he said, he that showed mercy on him. Then I love Jesus. Jesus did not explain himself. You know what I would have done? I would say, here, sit down. You don't understand the gospel. Sit down. I would have tried to explain everything. And so, and I do, it's different here, right? Because we're in a church setting and we do explain, but sometimes you gotta put it out there and realize the Holy Spirit is the one that explains it. Okay? And so he, I love what Jesus, he said to him, he that showed mercy on him, I love Jesus. Then said Jesus unto him, hey, go and do that likewise. And I could see the guy following him. The Bible doesn't say this, saying, but wait a minute, I don't know that I can do that. I don't think I can do that. You're getting the point. Nobody can without him doing it through us. See, religion, the Bible says the kingdom of God works like a seed. It's first the blade, then the ear, then the full corn in the ear, Mark 4:28. In other words, what religion does is they try to do the full corn in the ear without the blade in the ear. They just want to go right to the full corn because it's all about what it looks like. It's all about what it looks like to man. I want to be justified in the sight of man, so I have to do good works so it looks good. We believe in good works, but we believe in the good works God ordained, which are a result of the good work of what he did in us. That's the good works we believe in. And those good works don't stop. They keep going on and on and on and on. So, in closing, I want to share a couple things that we talked about on... I thought I was going to do that. Let me do John 13, 34 and 35, and then I'm going to do a quick run on Hebrews 10. What did I say? John 13, 34 and 35. Most of you know this, but I want you to see this. John chapter 3, a new commandment. Jesus speaking, a new commandment, not an additional commandment. Not adding a new commandment, an additional commandment onto the 613 Old Testament. He's saying, why is this a new commandment? I went back and looked in Leviticus, and he said to love your neighbor as yourself in Leviticus 19. So I'm thinking, how's this? Well, it is new, and here's why. Look at it. I give unto you that as ye love one another the same way that I loved you. That now this is going to be possible because of a new birth. Amen? And it's a commandment, guys. That which is prescribed to you because of who you are. When you accept Jesus, you become one spirit with him. You can do this because of who you are in Christ. But if you try to do this in the arm of the flesh or with the strength of the flesh, we fall flat every time. Now, so notice what it is. But notice what next verse. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples. By your great miracles and your words of knowledge and your words of wisdom, by your great Facebook post, all men are going to know that you're my disciples. By your love one for another. How are they going to know? One way, not two, not three, one way. You know what love is? Active involvement with one another. Satan's goal for every believer is to isolate them. You ever notice how your brain can do crazy things when you're by yourself? Nobody? Say you're depressed or you're dealing with something. You get by yourself and all of a sudden your brain starts messing with you. I believe demonic involvement, all those different things. But you can develop some crazy ideas. I remember one time I was going to write this guy a letter and just basically tell him, man, I'll tell you And I was totally out there. You know why? Because I was by myself and I was thinking about all this stuff. And next thing you know, it's like, that's why when, you know, your husband or wife, if you're married or whatever, and they do something and you get away and you meditate on it and you don't give it to the Lord, all of a sudden what started out this big becomes this big and then this big and then this big. Now this is what they did. Now let me tell you why they did what they did. Then you start judging their motives. Next thing you know, they're the worst thing that ever walked the earth. Right? That's how it works. Amen. Hebrews 10, quickly. I'm going to do this real fast. Hebrews 10, 19. We've done this before, but I didn't go this far the other time. I want you to see it, and we are wrapping up with 46 seconds. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. We're big on the blood here. All right? We have boldness by a new living way which he has consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. Next verse. And having a high priest over the house of God, a high priest represents us to God, right? Let us draw near with a true heart, an uncondemned heart, a heart that's not sin conscious, but righteousness conscious because of the blood of Jesus, right? That's a true heart. In full assurance of faith. Full assurance of faith. Of what? You're not going to be rejected. Isn't this all good? We love this. We talked about this. Having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience. An evil conscience, we've said this before, is a sin-conscious conscience. Thank you, Jen. Is a sin-conscious conscience. But you got to have your heart sprinkled by, what by? The blood of Jesus. Like they sprinkled the altar and different things in the Old Testament. They have to have your heart sprinkled. And our bodies washed with pure water. When your heart's sprinkled from an evil conscience, it'll cause your water, your body, your physical being to be washed. The water of the word you hear will be pure water. No, why? Because you're righteous conscious. You know, everybody hears the word that goes to church on Sundays, but what kind of word are they hearing? Are they seeing Jesus in the new covenant, or are they seeing rules and laws they have to obey? See, we're challenging you today, but not so you can be righteous. Somebody's got to hear the difference. We're telling you, you are righteous. And we're telling you, get in and function with other righteous people so you can function better. And the world can see. Next verse. Now, we talked about this one. Let us hold fast our profession or our confession, which means to say the same thing that God says, right? Let us hold fast our confession of faith without wavering. For he is faithful that has promised. Now, here's where I'm going. Now, watch these next two verses. And let us consider one another. Uh-oh. Now you want me to get involved with people. I don't know about that. I like the blood and being justified and my body washed with pure water. I love all that. But now you want me to get involved with people? Let us consider one another to provoke. Some of you think I do that really good, right? The word provoke means to stimulate, never manipulate. It literally contains the idea of irritation. I call it holy irritation. you irritate something. If I rub my hand here, because of the nerves that are in my hand, it stimulates, it irritates, and all of a sudden it gets hot and can get painful. But it says, consider one another to provoke unto love and good works. See, that's all connected to what we just said about being justified. Next verse. Keep the crowd tape running for a while. Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, encouraging one another, calling one another near, summoning one another, telling them they're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. In other words, it shouldn't be getting less, it should be getting more. Exhorting one another, being involved in one another's life. This 2016, I told you, I believe is the year of activation. We're trying to activate things. I met with a guy yesterday. We're trying to get a men's ministry going. We got a women's thing going. We're getting this stuff going, not to be doing something, but so we can love on one another and help each other. You guys got gifts resident in your heart, and God hasn't put that there for your ego. He put it there so you can use it to bless other people. That's why he says, provoke you to love. And notice what went with love. Good works. I love you. See, hope I don't see that guy again. Love involves involvement. Love involves working together. Look at that. Not forsaking, implying that we can forsake it. We can forsake it. You know, people, so many people pull away from church because they've been hurt by church. But it's still God's idea. And where we exalt the word of God and we exalt that, but it's not just, man, that's a good word. We hear a good message, but we get actively involved with one another. And that's what we're praying. See, I'm going to close with this. You know, we talk about praying. And here's, I'm going to show you the two ways the church misses it in prayer. Number one, we pray and then we just pray, right? Remember 2 weeks ago we did that message, are you obeying what you're praying, right? Come on, help me. We pray and then we just stop there. That's a mistake. Jesus said, I don't do anything except what I see and hear my Father do. In other words, when he prayed, the Father gave him a direction and he responded to it. Okay? So that's the number one way, or one way we miss it. The other way we miss it is people, well, just do something. Okay, we're doing this thing. We started this ministry. Oh, God, bless this ministry. That's wrong. What if God never called you to start that ministry? No. That's crazy. It's like a surfer trying to create a wave to surf on. He doesn't do that. He sees the wave that's coming in, and that's the wave he gets on. Why? Because it's already there. That's the way it needs to be with God's provision. We don't do things and ask God to bless it. We go to prayer and say, God, what are you doing? And how do you want us to respond? And where's the good works you've ordained for us to walk in? And that's where we want to go. Can you hear that? That's the love and good works we need to be provoked unto. See, religion is a great big counterfeit. It does a bunch of good things many times. But if they're not led of God, they're just filthy rags. They're not. It may profit and help people, but it doesn't mean it's God's plan for that person's life. God has a plan for us to walk in. So when we pray, we want to obey that direction. But at the same time, we won't just want to do and then not, and then ask God to bless it. We're wrong. Can you hear the difference? But this all involves involvement. How do we answer Jesus' prayer? Let's go back and we'll close with this. John 17:21. Can you still get it up? Thank you. John 17:21. Oh, so many. Look, I want you to, there, if you want some of these church verses, I got tons of them. Tons of them. They're all over the New Testament. I didn't realize how big God was on it. Here's Jesus' prayer, that they all may be one as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. Do you want the world to believe that God has sent Jesus? Yes or no? There's how it happens. when we operate as one, when we operate as a church. When we don't operate as a church, the world don't see it. I am determined this year. I've been studying, training myself. I said, Lord, I have got to be better. I've got to be a better communicator. I've got to be better at rallying the troops. But I don't want to be, oh man, wow, Chris can quote the Greek. Ain't he something? Whoop-dee-doo. I'm sure you guys can quote more than I can. It isn't about that. It's about being activated for the kingdom of God. That's what it's about. Amen. And that's what God has for you and I. And that 24/7, I love just going out. You know, God will give you opportunities all the time to minister to people. And then invite them to church. How can you say that? He must want people to come to church. So does Jesus. So does Jesus. It's not wrong, it's right. Hallelujah. Just because religion has perverted things does not mean we discard the baby with the bathwater, right? Amen. Amen. Are you blessed? Amen. Hallelujah.